Mission Audio presents Simple Joys, Discovering Wonder in the Everyday, written and read by Candace Payne. For Larry, Barbara, Mark, Tammy, and David, there has never been anything like the joy I have shared with you. I love you more than I could ever write, sing, or say. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. John chapter 15, verse 11. Preface. There's joy in them hills. I feel as though I should start this entire journey toward joy with a confession. I absolutely love reality television. Don't judge me. I know. I get how amazing awful it is. Yet I cannot stop watching. And it's not as if I just watch one particular category or genre of reality TV. No. If it's real-ish life, I'm there. From teenage moms to people living in the bush in Alaska, I will watch them all. One show in particular that I have successfully snared my husband's attention with as well is one where they follow the journey of a few different ragtag companies mining for gold. I don't know how or why this show became one of our favorites. Maybe it's the burly voiceover, the nifty graphic blueprint illustrations that explain what on earth terms exclusive to the mining world, or the fact that you never know if they're going to be successful finding gold or not. I am drawn to the lives of the people mining. I'm intrigued. Why would they risk so much time from their families and invest so much money on equipment on something that may or may not pan out? Y'all, I didn't even try to put that pun there. It just happened. Seriously, though, why waste so much effort and sacrifice so much for something like that? I've seen grown men jump up and down on this show over the tiniest speck of gold. The idea of gold mining isn't a new thing. It's rather old in our world. History has seen many a gold rush and many a person with gold fever. Can you even imagine the feeling of unearthing dirt and rock that look like nothing special, only to find one of the most valuable elements known to humanity hiding inside? It is a treasure hunt of epic proportions. And when I say treasure, that's an understatement. There's nothing quite like gold here on earth. Likewise, I have come to discover there is nothing quite like joy here on earth. And maybe the attraction I have to the television screen as I watch the struggles and success in gold mining has something to do with the way they mirror my own struggles and successes in finding joy. It has become a beautiful metaphor for uncovering the places we often overlook to find joy in our lives. As you listen to this book, I want you to become a prospector for joy. My hope for you is that you begin digging in unearthed places to discover pure joy just as eagerly as you would dig for pure gold. Go ahead, lift your eyes and hopes up through each chapter because there's joy in them hills. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. Chapter 1, The Year I Spent with My Head in the Clouds. I was performing a skit I wrote for a summer camp crowd of nearly 300 students, ages 12 to 18, on a stage in a large room that resembled a log cabin nestled in the mountains of Colorado. Suddenly, someone handed me an urgent message on a post-it note asking me to call my sister. It simply read, "Call home, 911. Now, this was a few years before cell phones were in the hands of everyone. I know. How did this world function without cell phones? In fact, we had these things called pay phones. And yes, true to their descriptive title, you had to pay to use them. with actual coins. Yeah, insane. Nevertheless, I ran down rocky steps and through tall pine trees until I saw a light shining from the one giant pole that also held the electric wires that supplied the dorms and camp cafeteria with modern comforts and electricity. At its base was a payphone. I picked up the receiver and prayed that I could withstand whatever news would come my way. Just weeks earlier, I had buried my sweet Grandpa Sharp, the first grandparent I had lost. I couldn't bear much more news of death in my family, but I was trying to prepare my heart for what might come. I dialed and waited for what seemed like a year with each ring. My sister finally answered, and I rushed to cut her off with, "I'm here. Got your message. What's up?" My sister hesitated to start her sentence, but was direct once she said, "Okay, well, I just saw on the news that your choir was in a plane crash. It's your friends, David, Bonnie, Allison. You need to find a TV to see what's going on and then try to come home." June 1st, 1999 was the date. I had just finished my sophomore year of college and was in an elect choir called the Washita Singers. Most of this choir had gone on an overseas trip that summer to perform in Europe at different churches and venues. It was an elective trip, since you would have to raise funds to go and pay for your own way. When given the option, I didn't want to go, but instead chose to work at the summer camp where I had worked the year before. A handful of others didn't go either, but most did. I was in shock. I had no clue who had survived, if any, of my core group of friends. I was gripped with fear and grief that I had lost them all. It wasn't until about an hour later that I got more facts about what had happened. American Airlines Flight 1420. It was the last leg of the trip home from the choir concert adventures, and the plane crashed as it flew from Dallas-Fort Worth to Little Rock, Arkansas. 11 of the 145 people aboard, the captain and 10 passengers, were killed in the crash. One of those passengers was a 21-year-old friend who lost his life when he refused to stop entering the flames to drag people to safety after the plane had crashed. He was a hero and a quiet young man who spent his life quite literally serving others. And our beloved choir director and his strong and sassy wife, who is also our accompanist and my personal voice teacher, would have to bury one of their young daughters just days later due to injuries sustained during the crash. I came home. I met with my friends who had survived. I hugged necks. I cried. I stayed quiet and let them talk. And we all tried to pick up the pieces of our lives the following semester as classes resumed. Because of this event in my life at the age of 20, I do not love to fly. I have seen the effects firsthand that come with the grief, loss, and devastation a crash leaves behind. Call me sensitive if you like, but I wouldn't even watch a movie if I knew it had a plane crash scene in it. I was in avoidance mode. I didn't want to remember that year following the crash and the effects it had on my friends, our community, and our joy. Now, fast forward nearly 20 years, it was May 19th, 2016, when I posted the Chewbacca Mom video that went viral. If you're listening to this, you may already have seen it and know about the video, but for those who don't know, it's a 4-minute video with 3 minutes of pure laughter and joy I experienced while wearing a toy mask that made funny sounds as I opened and closed my mouth. Sounds fun, right? Well, it was. I laughed and laughed like I hadn't laughed in years. And as the world began to share that video, that laugh became viral overnight and infected nearly 100 million viewers within days. I started getting invitations to appear on different television shows. Now, these shows were not a hop, skip, and jump away from my home. Nope. I had to fly in an airplane to get there. By June 1st, the anniversary date of Flight 1420's fatal crash, I had flown 6 times since I posted the video less than 2 weeks previously. This was more than I had flown in the preceding 18 years. Though I tried to enjoy every moment this fun and funny little viral video granted me, I was also gripped with fear and insecurity during every takeoff and landing. I kept on flying to media events and speaking engagements the following year. I did it so much, I learned how to navigate through security and not be that lady who holds up the line because she doesn't know all the rules. You know, the one who brings a giant bottle of aerosol hairspray and a large coffee through the line while wearing lace-up boots that take about 10 minutes each to take off. These days, I have it down. I wear easy off shoes to the airport and never wear a belt. I always have a Ziploc baggie full of appropriately ounced liquid toiletries. I don't mean to brag, but I've got this. I even came up with my own go-to routines to calm and course-correct my nerves during takeoff and landing. When I fly, I am never without the thought of that season from the crash. But I have learned a way not only to cope, but to do fairly well as a frequent flyer. One thing I always love to do while flying is look outside the plane window and see the clouds. On bright, sunny days, I find myself in awe of where I am, if only for a few minutes. I mean, that is an underrated simple joy I see passengers ignore every flight. Some get it, though. They are the ones you see lift the shade at the risk of waking their fellow row rider, push up their seat, lean forward, and stare. I get a feeling of wonder every time I look out a window to see that my head is literally in the clouds. All the fear I feel in getting up there and then coming back down to earth is washed away when I peer at the vast expanse of sky, clouds, and sunshine. It's a hidden place where I find a secret habitat not many get to see. Within the year following that viral video, I flew more than 40,000 miles. That has helped me retrain my mind to know that crashes aren't the norm. I have slowly and surely found enjoyment in traveling in the clouds. I have even a few times found takeoff and landing to be an afterthought. My hands no longer clutch the armrest, but instead are folded in my lap or engaged in expression as I talk with a new friend I've made in the seat next to mine. It has taken a year in the clouds to find the peace that has afforded me the simple joys of all the things flying can be: fun, exhilarating, and wonderful. Now, if you'd told me a year ago that I would ever describe flying in those terms, I would have looked at you as if you were crazy. But one flight with my children in particular gave me new cause to see it just like that. It was a last-minute request to come and speak for a friend at her church. I would need to fly myself and my kiddos with me from Fort Smith, Arkansas, to Sacramento, California, the following morning. I didn't have time to prepare my thoughts for flying. Preparation had become a huge advantage in calming my nerves, but this time, I couldn't. Nevertheless, I was with my children, and my mama bear instincts overtook anything else I would feel. We made it in plenty of time to the airport with moments to spare for last-minute restroom breaks and a coffee run for myself. My son was 7 years old. My daughter was 8. It was right in the middle of their summer break, and we were all excited about the spontaneous weekend adventure awaiting us in Cali. We settled into our seats and pulled out our handheld devices to entertain and distract us. The flight took off smoothly, and we were served snacks and drinks without a hiccup in the air. But during the last 20 minutes of the flight, we began to experience mild turbulence that would quickly turn into severe turbulence. And y'all, I don't say that lightly. This was crazy. I had felt turbulence that was choppy, but this was more than that. We began to jolt furiously. It felt as though we were in the hands of an irresponsible giant toddler in the sky playing with a toy airplane being swooshed and whooshed from side to side. I was not the only one who became genuinely concerned for our safety. A woman behind me began to yell in fear with grunts of, "Ooh," and "Please, God, no," mixed in. At times, the crowd let out a unified gasp of fear. Except this was no thrill ride at an amusement park. Our lives depended on a metal tube in the air fighting desperately to defy gravity. Everyone knew it. Well, everyone except my 7-year-old son. Duncan also began to make a ruckus.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.